like. Now it's time for a special video. Our good buddy Jamar Nicholas is going to be talking with another good buddy of Kids Love Comics, Kazu Kibuishi.
Well, hello. Well, hello. Look at those graphics. Hi, everybody. I'm Jamar Nicholas. You may remember me from Baltimore Comic-Con in real life, where you would always see me hanging out with my buddies at the Kids Love Comics Pavilion. And I'm the creator of Leon and the Leon series of books now at home at Scholastic Graphics. So it's great to see everybody. And I have a really special show for us today. I'm going to hang out and talk to my best bud, Kazu Kibuishi, and we're going to talk about what it's like to be a cartoonist and an author, and I'm going to ask him a bunch of questions he's heard a million times, but we'll have a lot of fun. So let's bring him in. Hey, Kazu.
Hey, Jamar.
How are you?
I'm doing good. Hey, and congratulations on becoming a part of the graphics family. I'm so happy about that.
Thank you, brother. Thank you.
So good to have you on the team.
Oh, I'm excited. Yeah, it's just begun. So I hope to have a very long career ahead of me at Scholastic. So, Kazu, thank you. Kazu, thanks for coming on with me today. The Baltimore Comic-Con gave me a really cool assignment to talk to some of my buds about their careers, and I figured, why not reach out to you? Because you've always been so nice and willing to give up your time, and we have a good energy together. So I figured I'd ask you some questions. And yeah, I've called this 10 questions with Kazu. Now, I don't know if we're going to get through 10, but we'll see what we can do. All right. So I'm going to ask these questions kind of like if I was a young person again and I got to like meet a famous person like you, Kazu, and ask some questions without shaking and getting all nervous, I would come up with at least these good questions. Okay. All right, so let's just start. So this is kind of a twofold question, a little bit about you coming of age as an artist and what you're using right now on your table. So the first question is, did you always draw, Kazu, and what are your favorite art tools?
I think all kids have drawn to start, right? So mm-hmm. I just didn't stop. So I think we all started drawing. Mm-hmm. And that's how we were communicating. And then people moved on to different things. And I'm the last kid out of the pool. Whenever there was like a birthday party, the parents mm-hmm. had to come get me because I just wouldn't stop doing the thing. That's how it's been for everything. Even comics, I think I wasn't into comics as much as my friends were. And I just wanted to hang out with my friends. So I started drawing them and I just didn't get out of the pool. I just kept going. Once I figured like, I'm like already sitting down, I'm drawing the cartoons. I'm like, well, you know, might as well go all the way. So that's how it started. But that's one of my favorite art tools. I like pencil and paper.
Mm, okay. Nothing fancy, right?
Nothing fancy. Just pencil, paper, eraser.
Yeah. Cool. All right. Our second question is, and you haven't seen these, so you have no idea what I'm going to ask you. Did you do other things when you were young, like play sports?
Oh, absolutely. I am an athlete. It's one of the reasons I didn't want to draw comics. I was like really afraid of the idea of sitting at a desk. I just thought I'm not going to be a desk jockey of any kind. There's no way. Mm-hmm. I even considered I thought about, oh man, maybe I could be like a smoke jumper or something. You know, I wanted to do something, you know, like just be a firefighter or, you know, help the world somehow, but be out on doing action adventure stuff. And then I saw like making of stuff for live action movies. Mm-hmm. And saw how much work it was where you're outside in the elements and you're shooting these, you know, these crazy scenes that's imaginary. Mm-hmm. And even though that's not really what I felt comfortable producing creatively, that kind of work, I thought maybe I should go into film because at least that takes care of the adventure side as well as the creative side. Mm-hmm. And so sports has been a big part of my life. I was a very good baseball player as a kid. I was good at tennis. I surfed and skated, and I'd say now, like, mostly I mostly mountain bike. I'm a I'm a pretty high level mountain biker, and a good snowboarder as well.
Wow.
And so I, yeah, and now I just started wake surfing, which, because I have no real waves around here. So now I'm just surfing the wake of boats.
Wow. And,
it is so much fun. I love it.
That's amazing. Our next question is, were your parents, there's a typo there, were your parents supportive of your decision to be an artist?
Yeah, actually, you know, I'm Japanese American, so, you know, typically, you know, well, I mean, as with most Asian American kids, I expected to be a doctor because my mom told me that's what I was going to be when I was a kid. I just just told her, yeah, I'll be a doctor, you know, just make her happy, you know, that's all good.
Yeah.
And so I started drawing a lot when I was a kid because I thought I wasn't going to do it anymore when I was older. So I was trying to get it out of my system. But by doing that, I ended up becoming good enough that people were asking me to do it for a living. But ever since my parents saw that that seemed to be the direction I was going in, they were 100% behind it from the start. So they never really, you know, tried to take me off of the track. In fact, you know, my mom was trying really hard to, like, help me. And it was, and I had to tell her to just back off.
Yeah.
Because it was sending me down different roads and, like, it wasn't the kinds of things that I was interested in. I mean, you know, she was putting me in touch with certain teachers and people who were, you know, wanting to coach me through these things. And I wanted to do it on my own. And so I had to lie to her and say, I quit drawing comics, Mom. And she was, like, so distraught. I was like, I quit. Because, like, I had too many people asking me to draw their books or
work
for them. And, you know, to be my mentor. Mm-hmm. And as nice as all these people were, I wasn't interested in being somebody else's career opportunity. I wanted to stay in, you know, control of the work that I'm going to do.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, this is actually one of the reasons I watch a lot of sports, because I think that it you know, I think sports and art are essentially, like, the professionals in sports and art are essentially in the same line of business.
Mm-hmm.
And we're all in the entertainment business.
Yeah.
You know, so if you're an athlete, you're there to entertain. That's how the money comes in. And if you're an artist, you're doing the same thing. So I look at athletes as models for how, you know, to manage life and career things. Because there's just so many more like highly focused, highly trained minds operating in professional sports than in the arts. And that's because people perceive that there's more money there to be.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Huh. Mm-hmm. Wow. These are, go ahead.
But they were supportive. Yeah. They were my parents, you know, actually I'll share a funny anecdote about my dad.
Okay.
So, like, a lot of people have their dads, like, giving them pressure to do certain things in their life. Mm-hmm. And everything. My dad, I mean, when he grew up, he was like in motorcycle gangs in Japan. I mean, he's basically in and around the Yakuza and stuff. And he was a tough guy. Like, when, you know, I had to get into physical altercations with him when we were kids. And when I was a kid, and man, it's like going, you know, it's like wrestling with a linebacker. I mean, he's huge.
Mm-hmm.
He's just so strong, like a really strong guy.
Yeah.
But, you know, he always told me, like, to just stay out of trouble.
Mm-hmm.
So when I asked him about grades and stuff like that, I, you know, he just said, just get C, just don't get F. And I'm like, okay.
I could do that. All right.
And he's like, yeah, stay out of jail. I'm like, okay, stay out of jail, just get straight C's. Yeah, you know, just don't be a troublemaker. And I feel like his low expectations allowed me to take agency over my success.
Wow.
I think he was a great dad. I mean, he's my stepdad, but he raised my brother and me really, really well.
Mm-hmm.
And my brother and I always think back on it and go, man, all that stuff we thought, like, maybe he was like out of it about, you know?
Yeah.
I think he's right. Like, he was really, there's wisdom there,
mm-hmm.
you know, like, he may not have the big, you know, the big resume. He might not have the big degree. He might not sound like the most spectacularly intelligent person, but he has a lot of life experience.
Yeah.
And he's rolled with a lot of punches. and he's come out in a good place, you know? And I think that all of that, like, made my brother and me a lot more humble, hardworking, just had better heads on our shoulders, I think. And we also didn't, you know, feel like we were going to fail him, because we just already knew we were in control of our destiny. Yeah. So that was good, you know? So my dad, Masa, good job.
That's awesome. Yeah. All right. Here's a different angle for you. Number four, kids all over the world love Amulet. What books fascinated you as a kid? What were you reading, Kazu, when you were little?
Jurassic Park. when we got that in like middle school, I think around that time, it was like it spread like wildfire.
Yeah.
And I was so jealous that the kids that were reading it in their class got to read it in their class. I didn't get to read it in my class. I went and read it, but I ended up reading all of Michael Crichton's books, because I was like, oh man, this is good, and this is good, and this is good. This is so much fun. I love these. I also love Rising Sun. Nobody ever talks about that. I'm a Japanese American, right?
Yeah,
and
yeah.
You would think, like, somebody might be like, oh, you probably don't like Rising Sun. I go, no, I loved it. That was awesome. If you're a non-Japanese writer, but you have like a real keen interest in the subject matter of the culture and stuff, and you know what you're talking about, like he does, go for it, man. Write that stuff. And man, it's awesome. It was awesome to read, and I really enjoyed it. So I also read, you know, like when I was younger, I read, you know, books like Shel Silverstein's books, and I was so super into the Phantom Tollbooth.
Yeah.
When I first came upon that, it was really nice to I got to meet Norton Jester and talk to him for a while, and we had a lot in common. That was really interesting.
Wow.
That's a good story too.
did you read like Choose Your Own Adventure books and things like that? Were you into that?
I always disliked Choose Your Own Adventure books.
Yeah, tell me why. That's interesting.
So, because like every single time, I'm a writer, I write stories and things like that. And even when I was a kid, I was writing stories, and I really was engaged with really good storytelling. And the Choose Your Own Adventure is like, it derailed the meaning from a book when you can move from one thing to another. Like there wasn't the consequence of a specific path or a set of choices that were made, because you're now making the choices and you may have a consequence, but it doesn't feel real. It doesn't feel like, you know, I'm actually getting to see the result of the choice.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'd rather imagine it. So it's like when I didn't want Legos with instructions. Just give me the bricks.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah,
you know, and I think a lot of kids are like that. I'm like one of those kids who just likes to be somebody giving me something to build off of, you know, to work with and build off of, rather than telling me like how it's done. And so it was weird that a book that says choose your own adventure felt less like I was choosing my own adventure, and I was just like running through somebody's very particular maze.
Yeah,
and none of it had real, like, intrinsic value to it, because it was just events that occurred. I don't learn anything
right
from a Choose Your Own Adventure book, and that's why I choose not to read Choose Your Own
Adventure. I like what you did there. That was nice. All right, here we go. Number five. Is there anything you don't like to draw?
I'm just like anybody else. I hate drawing horses. And until the last book, even though I am a big time cyclist, I have a hard time with bicycles too, but I'm better at it now because I know how bicycles work. So I'm starting to enjoy bicycles. I still have not learned to enjoy drawing horses. They're really hard, and I'm not a fan.
I think that's funny because I was talking to some other cartoonist last week about horses, and everyone's just like, horses!
I know, man, horses. They're so hard. There's some people I know, like artist Alex Neonakis, who used to work with us. Her horses are incredible. So some people who love horses and are around horses, I think they can draw horses all day long. I just don't have that skill.
I bet there's a horse somewhere that doesn't like drawing you, Kazu.
Yeah. Well, there's another one. I hate drawing me.
Oh, you don't like doing portraits?
Yes, I hate drawing self-portraits. If someone asks me for one, I'm like, oh gosh, that's like a, they asked me to, that's one of the things I hate to do.
All right, so we won't have you draw yourself at the end of the episode. No, I can draw me. All right, number six. Does your family enjoy your books?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. My kids are big fans, and they're like first read editors on the books too, and they read a ton. They're big time readers. I mean, they read every all day long. I mean, my son wakes up at like 6 or 7 in the morning before everybody and just reads.
Wow.
You know, and so, you know, he's always reading. I mean, we don't push that stuff on him. He just likes books.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's great.
Plenty around. Yeah. he loved Leon. That was one of the, you know, that was a big one. I was like, he actually came to me after he read that one. He's like, this is really good.
Oh, wow. That's really
good. Like, I love this. This is really, really good. I'll go.
Thank you.
Just wondering why it's not with a big publisher.
Here we go. No, that's really special. It's great to hear that. Thank you. Yeah. Number seven, would you want your kids to be artists? Why or why not?
I mean, I want them to have agency, so I want them to decide. If they decide to be artists, it's awesome. And they already do draw a lot. I don't know where they're going to take it. Neither of them have it in their mind to be artists when they grow up. Mm-hmm. My youngest, my daughter, she wants to be a paleontologist. So she wants to work with dinosaurs. And the older one wants to build robots. So so we have to make sure that he's a good guy. And we tell him, you know, be Dr. Light, not Dr. Wily.
That's right. If you have to pick, be Dr. Light.
Go make Mega Man. not the villains.
It's funny you said the paleontologist, because it just made me think about the Jurassic Park line you just talked about. That's interesting.
That's interesting. I guess we made steam. Amy and I just made steampunk kids. Because one wants to go into the future and one wants to go into the past.
I love it. Everybody has goggles on in your house. So. Okay, let's try this one. Number eight. If you were an artist, what would you be doing right now?
I think I'd probably work working in the field of architect. I would have stayed in architecture, but not as an architect. I'd probably be doing real estate development. I would be a developer of a kind, you know, with a real focus on sustainable buildings and stuff. I really think I could have done a lot if I stayed doing that and to try to push for better sustainable designs. If I were on that track right now and working in build, like still working around buildings and things like that, I would be really working on institutional architecture, like a real focus on trying to redesign schools.
Wow.
You know, and that I think is something that I want to do through my books too. So I basically didn't land too far from what I probably would have been interested in. My interest right now is to create better, you know, early childhood and middle grade education. I think if we can get all that stuff lined up, I think we see a lot less problems in all these other fields. So, you know, what drives me when I make my comics would probably drive me working in real estate and architecture. And I think I could have done that pretty well. So I imagine that's what I would have done.
Oh, wow. Yeah. That's really exciting. And it's very, selfless too, you know. It's kind of like, you know, you would want a career where you're helping other people through your hands in a way. Yeah.
Well, I mean, the things that I'm selfish about, like the things that I want for myself, can be attained fairly easily. I don't really, you know, just enough money to like live a decent and comfortable life, and my kids are having a good time and are having stuff.
Yeah,
I don't want, you know, I'm not into, I definitely didn't go into comics for both money and fame. I would have been a foolish kid if that was the case. So I'm just like anybody else. I was doing it, you know, back when it wasn't cool. Right. So, I mean, I just liked it. It's just a thing that I thought that had some value. I didn't really I didn't understand it at the time, how valuable it could be. But, you know, even as, like I just talked about architecture and development of real estate and various like commercial and residential real estate. And if you think about it, so much of like modern like design, like architectural design and stuff for like for the entertainment world comes from Disney. Walt Disney was a cartoonist as well, you know, and so he developed all of that stuff. Like, I mean, so much of people's like minds are like probably molded by Disney.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. And what was he but a cartoonist, you know?
Yeah.
So, you know, it's interesting. In fact, you know, here's an interesting tie in to comics is that, Bob Iger, who has probably been the most successful CEO, he has been the most successful CEO that Disney has ever had, right?
Mm-hmm.
Bob Iger's uncle, I believe it's his uncle, worked with Will Eisner
back
in the day.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, Eisner and Iger was the Iger. Iger was Bob Iger's uncle.
Wow. Yeah. I never connected that. Yeah.
Yeah, isn't that crazy? So you know, it's kind of stayed in the family, all that stuff, but it's all kind of built around cartoonists.
Yeah,
you know, they start the ball rolling, and it becomes a big ball.
Mm-hmm.
And if the early ball roller had a good plan, then the big ball, you know, rolls smoothly.
Yeah,
and that's, you know, that's like if you look at Miyazaki, it's the same thing. Except he's worked for years to shun the responsibility of becoming like a Tezuka, like a Disney.
Yeah,
you know, he wanted to keep it small.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's afraid of it becoming Disney.
Right.
Of what he does, yeah.
Well, we could do a whole other episode about Miyazaki. No, that's amazing.
Yeah.
All right, cool. Number 9. What would you tell a parent who didn't want their kid to become an artist?
Well, first off, they can come listen to one of my talks. I changed their mind real fast. They'd be like, oh my goodness, he just said Disney's everywhere.
Right.
That means my son is going to make a lot of money, which is a terrible thing. It's a terrible way to get into it, by the way.
Yeah, yeah.
It should not have that expectation. But yeah, it's important. We need artists. Actually, we need artists. We need more artists than possibly ever, because there's so much happening in terms of quick lines of communication. Like we have so much fast talking, fast flashing information coming all over the place, and all of that has to be designed, and it is being designed by people, and they're often being designed by artists that are very skilled and very fast at what they do. So you need really good artists who are really fast at what they do, but also have good heads on their shoulders, so they're not allowing the tools that they have at their disposal to be used for nefarious means.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it happens, and it's not because of people who are being evil or something like that. It's just human nature. People just want to make money. They want the quick buck. They want to. They unintentionally hurt people because they didn't think things through. But if you have people who think things through and are creating things with their hands and their minds, you know, and you have the creatives on board being, you know, your good guys essentially.
Yeah.
You know, it can combat a lot of the communications errors that we see all over the world. I think a lot of the problems that we have right now are due to a lack of good communication.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's almost in every case. I could probably dial it down to this is bad communication. That's what's happening. People aren't talking to each other the right
way. And just to add on to this one, have you had a lot of parents and guardians ask you questions like this? Say, I'm sure you've been in a place where a parent has their kid who wants to show you their work, right? Show Mr. Kazu your drawings. And then in my head, I'm thinking the next question is, can you make money doing this? Should I tell him to stop? He really likes drawing. Is it okay? Like they're maybe asking for your recommendation or permission as a parent.
That's true. They want my blessing, I suppose. And,
yeah, yeah.
You know, I don't know. I So I imagine that even all these kids, these parents who talk about the money stuff, I think they're not after the money so much as some kind of a life security thing. Like they want the kids to be okay.
Yeah.
You know, they're not destitute, that they're not, you know, getting themselves into some kind of trouble. I think they don't want to see that. If they see, then they see me talking and I sound like a doctor, because I probably would have been. otherwise, you know, they're like, wow, like you can be like a doctor of comics and things like that, like Dr. Tezuka, right?
Yeah.
You know, I'm also really hesitant to, first off, I love that when parents like that come to me, I get really happy. Because it means they're taking their kids' vocation very seriously. And the thing that I want to see more of is making sure that those kids take their vocation seriously.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that they're not, that they know the responsibility that they have in front of them, that they don't offload it onto a school or like a corporation that will hire them.
Mm-hmm.
That artists need to stay as independent as they can manage to be. You know, sometimes you have to work with bigger companies and things like that, but at the same time, it's really important that they maintain their creative control for the sake of the corporations that they work for mm-hmm. the sake of just people in general. I think artists need to stay independent. And that's a really hard thing to stay keep when you're young. Like you end up deferring. And so with the parents become the first groups that unintentionally start taking the agency away from their kids. And mm-hmm. in order to just hedge against the kids failing, because they don't know anything about the arts, because maybe they're not artists.
Right.
So what they'll say is, well, I don't know anything about the arts, but I want to make sure that you make money. So let's have you go to an art school where you pay $60,000 a year to go to it.
Yeah.
But what if they can't afford that $60,000 a year? And now that kid's sitting, you know, back with a tremendous amount of debt coming out of school. So, you know, he or she was probably not the best candidate to go to an art school,
mm-hmm.
you know, and the parents didn't know any better. Kids didn't know any better. They both ended up guiding themselves into a problem.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So, you know, so I'm always really, really, honest about that type of thing. Like if to step it back, make sure that the kids do have, they have, if they say, mom, dad, I have to go to this art school, because they've already done the research and said, this is the school I need to go to. This is what mm-hmm. I really want to do.
Mm-hmm.
That's something to consider, you know, because that's, they're gonna, even if it's a mistake, at least they've made the choice. So they know, they can feel it. They can feel the mistake. So they can learn from it.
Right.
But if you send them there, then they're going to blame you for that mistake, if it becomes a mistake.
That's spoken like a father.
Yeah, I'm a dad, you know, but I mean, my kids aren't in college yet, but I want to make sure that they know that they're in control of their lives. You know, like it's mm-hmm. like what we do with just like our cups and dishes. Like we're like, you take that to the sink, you know, and
mm-hmm.
this is, we make sure that they can get to their cups and dishes and things like that. And like, you get your cups, you get your water, you get your stuff. We're not harsh. We're really soft on our kids, you know, relative to what I had to deal with.
Right. Yeah. I bet.
But at the same time, you want to make sure that they never lose their agency.
Mm-hmm. Wow, that was a great answer. All right, last one, and you're off the hook. Number 10, drawing is a lot of work, Kazu. What do you like to do to relax? And you gave us a little snippet of that at the very beginning. What do you like to do when you're not in the middle of a project?
Well, number one is spending time with my wife, Amy. That's number one. And mm-hmm. number two, that's like right there at number one, pretty much, is being with the kids. Mm-hmm. I mean, number one, that's just being with my family is number one. I don't care what we do, go to the pumpkin patch, just hang out. So that fills up almost all that space. Now I have to like also take care of my mental health. So I do sports mostly. You know, a lot of people might go, hey, you know, why are you spending all that time mountain biking? Well, that helps me with my work.
Mm-hmm.
Like when I go climb, you know, when I climb like 3,500 feet and then like come flying down it on a mountain bike, you know, that 3,000 foot climb feels like making a book. Like, for example, that's part of the process of this. It just gets my brain wired to like make my books. So I get on my bike and I start the climb, right? And this is going to be like, I'm like Tiger Mountain in Issaquah, Washington. It's like legendary for like it's a burly climb, amazing downhill. But you always hit a wall the first, probably the first, 5 minutes, 10 minutes. After 15 minutes, you hit this wall and you're like, oh my goodness, knowing that I have to do this for another hour or something up the mountain, I don't know if I can handle it.
Yeah,
you feel it in your gut, but that's because your body's in a bit of shock because you're not doing that every day, and all of a sudden your body's like, "Whoa, hey, whoa,
wait a second,
what are you doing?" And we're like, "We're gonna do this for the next hour and a half, 2 hours. We're gonna climb a mountain for 2 hours," and your body's like, "No way!" And the thing is, your body gets used to it. You have to just like work past it, and eventually it gets used to it. And it's the same with making a graphic novel. Because when you know, like for me, the second half of the climb, I don't even think about it. It's like it becomes unconscious. I'm just doing it, you know.
Right.
Whereas like with graphic novels, it's similar. That first half is so hard. You can never judge yourself based on the speed it takes to make the first half of your book.
Mm-hmm.
You got to judge it by the whole thing. That means you got to complete it. So if you don't complete a graphic novel, then you don't know what it's like to make one.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're going to have the wrong idea. That first half is harder because you are creating the problem.
Right.
The second half, you're answering the problem. It's much easier to answer questions that are there than to devise questions that you will answer later. Much harder. So, you know, remember that there's an uphill climb. And what do I do to do that? I go mountain biking. It reminds me every time. Kicks my butt.
Wow.
That first half. I'm like, oh, here it is again. Okay, this is just like the writing process. Just get through it and then just keep going. And then when I get down to get back home and like I feel great for one, mentally I'm great. I'm doing well.
Mm-hmm.
I sit down and I start working and I'm like, just like, it's like nothing. Come on, just do it. Just get over it. Just put some boxes in there. Fill those boxes. Let's go.
I love it. Wow. Well, thank you so much, Kazu. I thought we'd have some time to draw, but we're out of time.
We're out of time. You don't know what you need to see me draw right here. Everyone, you should be drawing. Go draw something. Draw anything.
That's right, you guys. Get to drawing. Kazu, this has been great. Thank you so much. And thanks for answering these 10 questions. I hope you like my questions.
I did. I do. I like them. It was good. Thanks, Jamar. And congratulations on Leon. And I'm really just I'm excited to see what's in store.
Oh, thank you, brother. I appreciate that. Yeah. And thank everybody for hanging out with us for 30 minutes. There's more programming to come. So hang out and see what happens next at the Kids Love Comics area of the Baltimore Comic-Con online. Thanks a lot. We'll see you in a little bit.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Hey, that was awesome. I think we had a really good time there with Jamar and Kazu Kibuishi. And if you search for them online, you can find their books as well as some more tutorials, more drawings, more interviews. Jamar also hosts the Pencil to Pencil podcast with Mike Manley. That's more for traditional comics creators and as well as new ones. So I think that's something that you should all check out.